Third, the government must be even-handed so as to be trusted to hold the reins if conflicts arise. We have enacted the Maintenance of Religious Harmony Act, which enables the Minister for Home Affairs to restrain any person from causing ill feelings between the different religious groups. It signals the seriousness with which we view religious harmony and how fragile it could be. The act is therefore to be used as a last resort. Unfortunately, we have not had to invoke it throughout this 21-year history. Despite our best efforts, tensions can still boil into the open from time to time. Religious fervor is rising here in Singapore, as it has all over the world, with all faiths. Just this year alone, several incidents here have hit the headlines. For example, there were reports of church youths evangelizing to unaccompanied children at playgrounds. There were also cases of church pastors trivializing and belittling Taoist and Buddhist beliefs. All this naturally caused great annoyance and potential tension. In one case, after our internal security department intervened, the pastor apologized for the offense he had caused. In other cases, the churches and pastors responsible on their own also regretted the incidents, apologized for causing offense, counseled their young members, and explained the guidelines of evangelism to the congregations. This go a long way to diffuse attention and avert potential conflict. Singapore's religious harmony is the result of continuous and conscious effort with various stakeholders playing critical roles. At a personal level, Singaporeans of all faiths must continue to show tolerance and understanding and adopt a live and let live approach to life. In addition, Singaporeans must remain vigilant of disparaging remarks or divisive or radicalized ideas by religious leaders. Followers have a social duty to speak out against those who hold offensive views towards other religions or communities. It is only through such swift and categorical rebuttals that people from other religions can be reassured that the offensive views are not held by the religion's mainstream members. In conclusion, we must accept that religious pluralism will increasingly be the norm of the modern world. The challenge faced by Muslim leaders and scholars is especially acute because many of them receive their theological training and inspiration from countries where Islam is dominant and where adaptation of Muslim practices to suit a multicultural society is given less emphasis. For this reason, I commend MUIS for organizing this conference with the Oxford University, the Department of Malay Studies in NUS, and the National Center for Excellence for Islamic Studies in the University of Melbourne. We are fortunate to have with us distinguished scholars from a range of backgrounds whom we can learn a great deal from. I would like to congratulate the organizers for the vision and timeliness of this conference, and I wish all speakers and participants a fruitful exchange of views over the next 2 days. Thank you.